as if you asked a modern-day furniture manufacturer to give each of its employees axes and send them out into the woods to cut down wood to make furniture with. That's not how you make furniture today, and you don't make music today in the same way that you did 100 years ago. You know, the fact is that the new media do allow musicians to explore sounds, to literally make more music in their own terms than they could have with the older media. The only people who are objecting are the people who don't take the trouble to learn the new media and participate in it.
I think that the electronic technology offers us the possibility of divorcing ourselves from the necessity of virtuosity without divorcing ourselves from the possibility of intense and meaningful interaction with our instruments.
We just heard from Robert Moog and Donald Buchla, two men who have a vested interest in what they say, since they're both regarded as the first inventors of the modular, voltage-controlled synthesizer. Their instruments, ideals, and musical philosophies form a latticework of both overlapping and diverging thoughts. But the instruments that bear their names mark the turning point of electronic music.
Totally Wired, artists in electronic sound. The music of yesterday may never be the same. The music of tomorrow may be sounds we've never heard. We live in an electronic world. These are the sound shapers of our era. Totally Wired.
I think the synthesizer was the first instrument that gave musicians a systematic way of stretching the limitations of sound production. Of exploring new sounds, not just finding a new sound, but actually covering whole areas of new sounds in a systematic way.
Throughout the 1960s and 70s, the name Moog was synonymous with the synthesizer. In fact, the history of electronic music can be conveniently divided as before Moog and after Moog. Before Moog, electronic instruments were cumbersome hodgepodges of wire and circuitry, labored over by an academic elite. After Moog, synthesizers became readily available, and more importantly, playable. Like the Moog synthesizer, Robert Moog was a child of the electronic age.
Electronics was a hobby of mine since I was 8 or 9 years old. I used to build little radios and experimental amplifiers with my father. In the magazines that catered to electronic hobbyists, there were always articles on how to build a one-tube organ or how to build this sound producer or that keyboard instrument. I used to build all that stuff, and one of the instruments I built was a theremin. It was a hobbyist version. It was very simple. A theremin is a musical instrument that you play by waving your hands around it. That got me hooked because the method of control was so unusual and the sounds it produced were unusual. I think I built my first theremin when I was 14, and by the time I was 19, I was actually selling them for money.
The theremin made eerie sound effects for countless science fiction thrillers, as well as hit records like the Beach Boys' Good Vibrations. But this record, produced by Shirley and Robert Moog, is by classical theremin virtuoso Clara Rockmore. Moog was involved with electronic music in its seminal days during the 1950s. He worked closely with the classical avant-garde at realizing new sound devices and recording techniques.
As far as the experimental musicians were concerned, they went looking not in musical instrument stores, but in laboratories and in broadcasting stations. and in computer rooms for unusual electronic equipment that could change sounds electronically in a variety of ways, ways that had not been accessible before that. It was a process of discovery for musicians at that time. Every new electronic musical instrument or a new electronic device you put their hands in was virgin territory to be discovered, to be investigated, to be developed musically into something that could be integrated with other musical material.
The Moog synthesizer grew out of the composer's needs, but like a benign Frankenstein, their desires were eclipsed by its seemingly limitless potential. Robert Moog created a modular system which connected several devices in a telephone operator-style patch bay with a small chromatic keyboard.
We began making modular electronic music equipment. It was modular in that every single piece of it did one thing and only one thing in either producing or shaping sounds electronically. The musician himself would connect these together with telephone-like patch cords. Of course, back then, this was back in 1964 now, when we began with the modular equipment, that most of our customers were academic people working in studios. Nobody who performed on stage would in his right mind take this sort of stuff on stage back then. You can take a synthesizer today, and if we built them, I can tell you which musician gave us the idea for them. Well, the very first musician I worked with was Herb Deutsch, who was at that time a composer at Hofstra University. Out of working with Herb Deutsch, we got the idea of the voltage-controlled oscillator, the voltage-controlled amplifier, and the keyboard controller. From Gustav Chamaga of the University of Toronto, we got the idea for the voltage-controlled filter. From Vladimir Yusachevsky of the Columbia-Princeton Electronic Music Center, we got the idea, in fact, he specified what's called the envelope generator, the part of the instrument that actually shapes the sounds as it goes on, as well as an envelope follower. An envelope follower is something that imparts the envelope or the shape of one sound to another sound. From Walter Carlos, the producer of Switched on Bach, we got the idea of a bank of filters which provided a new way of coloring sound, just as you would color a painting with yellow or red. A filter bank colors the sound. And so it goes. All of the early collaborators contributed at that stage to aspects of the synthesizer which are now accepted, widely accepted.
The early prototypes weren't playable live, but by the time of the Moog System 3, people were hearing the synthesizer in concerts and on the radio. One of the first artists to perform regularly on it was Keith Emerson of Emerson, Lake & Palmer on their hit Lucky Man. The modular Moogs were difficult and unreliable in live performance. It was the mini Moog that ultimately pushed the synthesizer into popular consciousness forever.
Well, the big switch that we made was in 1970 when we designed the mini Moog. The mini Moog is a direct derivative of the modular equipment, but it's designed without the ability to patch everything into everything else. But it's designed in a much smaller package so that a guy could actually carry it. We thought we were designing it for studio musicians who wanted to have an instrument that they could use on the gig, to take into recording studios and use as a trombonist would use his trombone. We had no idea that these people would actually take them on stage and tour with them.
But indeed, rock and fusion artists took to the pitch-bending mini Moog with a vengeance. Jan Hammer, then the keyboardist with the Mahavishnu Orchestra, was one of the first, and he defined its sound for a decade to come. Carlos's Switched on Bach was the first popular Moog record, and the one that ignited the controversy of imitative synthesis.
I'm just afraid they're going to lose their jobs. It's as simple as that. Some people have a vague fear that the computer is taking over and the machine's taking over. Well, if you let the computer and the machine take over, then I guess it's a worry. I'm personally more concerned that unethical people will take over than computers and machines. I'm not worried about computers and machines at all. Well, we're certainly not interested in designing instruments that make known sounds, because that's a futile effort. Electronics simply is a different medium than wood or brass or leather or any of the other materials that are used by musical instrument designers. On the other hand, we're not interested in making new sounds simply for the sake of newness. We are interested in putting new types of control under the fingertips and under the command of musicians. As it turns out, that the most distinctive thing, for instance, about a violin sound is not the waveform, not how the string vibrates, but what you can do with your fingers on the strings in order to control the sound. The same is true of the piano, the piano action, which allows your fingers to control how the hammers hit the strings, is the most important part of the instrument. And we're interested now in developing new ways of controlling sounds using electronic circuitry.
Robert Moog sold his interest in the Moog Corporation a few years ago, but he's still creating new instruments and is looking towards the future of digital technology.
I think the electronic musical instruments of the future will not look like anything that they look like today. The traditional organ keyboard will give away to very specialized, sensitive, finely tuned control devices, something that may look like a violin or a guitar neck, or may look like a saxophone body, something that you can move your hands around very easily and change sound very rapidly. The other way I see is more, this is a technological factor, I see the use of computer technology as becoming more and more important in musical instruments. Digital techniques have the potential for making richer sounds for less money and with higher musical content than the present day analog synthesizers do. But people are already beginning, and they they make sounds that no analog instrument could make at all. I think that's where it's all going technologically.
And what about the old Moog System 3, Mini Moog and Micro Moog? Will they become the relics of a past age, like antique Model Ts, or even dinosaurs?
Rather than dinosaurs, they'll probably become workhorses. That they'll always have some value. You would never think of, say, a Stradivarius violin as a dinosaur. It's a workhorse. It's something that has enduring value. And I think both the System 3 modular system, which was responsible for an awful lot of hit records, and the Mini Moog are going to be in that category.
I wouldn't call anything that I've ever built a synthesizer, and I first started designing members of the electronic family of instruments in 1962.
Donald Buchla introduced his modular system about the same time as Moog. But while Moog caught the public fancy, Buchla became a cult figure among synthesists and technicians. While the list of musicians who play Moogs is studded with luminaries like Carlos, Hammer, Rick Wakeman, Keith Emerson, and others, Buchla's best-known musician is Morton Subotnick.
I've been an experimentalist since my early childhood. I've been interested in avant-garde and experimental music far more than I have been as a composer in traditional form and structure. And my instruments have reflected that need.
Like Moog, Buchla began his work in the classical electronic music studios of the 60s. In his case, the San Francisco Tape Music Center.
Well, the studio of the early 60s, the so-called traditional studio, was equipped with an array of electronic instruments, none of which were designed for music. The concept of designing electronic instruments was new at the time. They were specific to music. Oh, my first instrument was a device that read the shape of the hand and interpreted it as a wave shape. And I think embodied the philosophy that a musical instrument had to be highly interactive with the human being that was playing it. It was a way of transcending the limitations of the instruments that I was acquainted with, which tended to be Hewlett-Packard oscillators and Ampex test equipment and borrowed World War II gun sights and things. I see the electronic family of instruments as being as significant as the string family, or the membrane family, or the wind family, as being a new way of generating sound. And perhaps even more significant because of certain kinds of flexibility that are allowed, because certainly the reduction of emphasis on virtuosity, and certainly the possibilities of instantaneous remapping of the instrument, and the possibilities of investigating and utilizing input structures that in themselves enjoy a dimensionality that is impossible given the limitations of setting physical bodies into physical motion. The piano is a one-dimensional instrument because the limitations of throwing hammers at strings are very severe. And the concept of building that into a multi-dimensional instrument with an incredible dynamic range and more than 88 keys are simply formidable.
On a whim, Buchla decided to demonstrate the prototype for his new Series 400 system for Totally Wired's producer John DiLiberto. It's a digital system with the electronics housed in a case no larger than a medium-sized suitcase, and has one of Buchla's well-known touchplate keyboards. He also uses a video monitor, which displays waveforms, notes and parameters of notes, various interactions, instrument storage, and other aspects which can all be seen and altered.
Can we start it up?
Yeah, it started by turning the power on. We're presented with a menu of possibilities, including various means of interacting with instrument definitions, scores, tunings, wave shapes, methods of storing in ear, all of the above, and some blanks for future expansion, etc.
So how do we start here?
Let's start by defining an instrument. And this menu on the TV screen corresponds geometrically to this array of 16 keys over here. It looks a little bit like a touchpad on a telephone. If we touch a 4, we can now define an instrument in terms of its responses. This display allows us to describe the onset of a note, the passage, let's say, of a note.
And so the pitch, timbre, index level, filters are all parameters of the note.
Yeah, and each of those can be graphically defined. So if I wanted to, we'll first define an instrument, call it instrument number 10. So we type a 10, and then we will listen to it on voice A, and we will define first a level, that being a very important parameter.
What does level mean? What does that mean?
It's in this context, it means the instantaneous amplitude of the note. And we could talk about it in classical terms if we chose to.
Are we talking about attack and decay?
Yes, okay. Those would be the classical terms. So let's give a fast attack, and we type an A0, which is hexadecimal notation for 10 volts. And then we assign a new point that says 0, 0 for simplicity. And we will say, let it be half a second. So that would be the decay time. Now we should be able to hear that sound. So that's the instrument we just defined, with a level and a filter.
Now, when you're defining this instrument and you're keying in all these numbers, you don't really know what it's going to sound like, do you?
Well, this is a new instrument, and I didn't know what it would sound like. I'd listen to this, and I'd say, what would happen if I change this knob here? And a clear change in timbre results. And here I'm going to increase the level, which will be a reverberant kind of thing. And then here's some filter. Gets a bit strident, and down, and then I can move the cursor, and this is all very interactive. I can define a frequency of 100, whatever that means, and a timbral modulation, and then I can turn up the timbre, or the index of modulation. You'll recognize 12-tone nature of this particular kind of software. It's because we have to sell some of these instruments before we can bathe in the lap of luxury that's going to be granted for us. But lest you think we can't create more bizarre instruments, we will call forth number 14. Aha!
While many of the sounds we've been hearing have smooth, hill-like wave shapes on the video screen, this one looks like a coastal map of Norway.
So we're departing a little bit from the traditional concepts of what a note is all about, in that when I touch a single key, that's the response I get. Those parameters, as you can see, are all accurately described graphically and numerically, if I choose to go down and look at the values and the times that are associated with each of the intermediate points. Now, if we really decided that we were ready to compose, then we could head over to the score editor, and then we would start playing in.
To compose on this instrument, Buchla first plays a line into the computer on the keyboard. Then he assigns the lines different instrumental voices and designations.
And then we could go back and listen to that. Maybe we wouldn't want to. We're now listening to the score played backwards. I think I'll change the instrumentation. We'll now play instruments 17, will we? No, looks like 11. Didn't like 17. 16 and 14 into the score. We add some more voices. We're now doing a rotational polyphonic assignment amongst instruments 11, 16, and 14.
So you would program something in there, and that played back, and then you were laying more things in on top of
it. Yeah, I went back. This is like an ideal tape recorder.
Uh-huh.
And I threw some more instruments and voices in. And now I could go back again if I wanted to, which I don't. And I could alter the dynamics, and I could alter the stereo location. All of these things can be called from the score. And I could change the instrumentation and tune the responses and delete any notes that I didn't like and restart any that I didn't like and so on. It allows the possibility of interaction at other than the traditional level. We can interact at the structural level instead of the note level of our music. We don't have to play every note. And that may seem, to some people, that seems very offensive, actually, the idea that we don't have to play each and every note. But to others of us, it seems very liberating. And we can deal with higher levels of performance time than simply playing notes. I don't know what it's called. Well, I think we've blown that one.
Totally Wired, Artists in Electronic Sound, was produced by John DiLiberto and Kimberly Haas for radio station WXPN in Philadelphia. Funding was provided by Sequential Circuits Incorporated, makers of electronic keyboard instruments, Yamaha Corporation, makers of electronic and acoustic instruments, the Pennsylvania Humanities Council, and the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts.